Thank you, Steve. When we're on the record, I have a couple of announcements.
This is case 2022-0198, petition of Pamela Smart.
Thank you. For the benefit of those in attendance, we will hear this case and then take a break. I understand that Mr. Brewer and Channel 9 will be here perhaps for the second case, but I think a lot of people will want to depart, and we'll allow that to happen. As the record shows, Chief Justice McDonald is recused from this case, and Mr. Sisti, you have reserved 2 minutes for rebuttal.
I have. Thank you, Your Honor.
Please proceed.
Thank you, and good morning. My name is Mark Sisti, and may it please the court, I want to first thank you for allowing us to make this argument. I represent Pamela Smart, and I have been representing Pamela Smart for 33 years. I represented her when she was arrested. I represented her when she was at trial, when she was convicted, and when she was sentenced to life without parole. I represented her when she was shipped off to the maximum security prison in New York at Bedford Hills. I represented her throughout her stay there, when she was sexually assaulted there by a correctional officer, when she was beaten so badly that she needed facial reconstruction surgery, when she earned 2 master's degrees and a doctorate. I have tried to represent her in front of the governor and council 3 times. The last time that we tried to represent Pamela Smart in front of the governor and council was on March 23rd, 2022. The governor and council gave Pam Smart 2 minutes and 34 seconds of their attention.
That was at the public proceeding?
That was at the proceeding where they had 128 particular items on it.
I appreciate that, but there were filings, significant filings, up before that time, right?
Before that, we had requested relief, I believe, in 2005 and 2015.
But I think what Justice Hicks is referring to are the materials that were filed with the Executive Council for this proceeding. There were substantial materials, some of which have been provided to us,
right,
filed by you and also by the state, correct?
There were enormous amounts of material.
And we don't really know how much time they individually gave to those materials, so it's really not fair to say they just gave her 2 minutes of their time.
No, I think it is fair, quite frankly, because you know what? That's a great question. That would have been a wonderful question to ask and to delve into if we had an opportunity to actually sit down and have a hearing. They did not exercise discretion.
Let me just skip ahead. You're doing very well, but let me just skip ahead. If we were to hold that she was required a hearing of some duration, wouldn't we then be down the, forgive the expression, slippery slope of deciding whether it was an adequate hearing or what kind of hearing, what evidence may be, how long the hearing should last?
Well, I mean, quite frankly, the state's argument is that the executive branch, the governor and council, should be able to run their own show, and I understand that. I do. But it has to be at least minimal due process. And what's happening now is that the public is not aware of what took place. Justice Donovan, in fact, brought up an excellent example of that. We don't know if they even looked at one page of what we submitted.
Well,
we
don't know. The court's business to know.
It is, especially in this case. You know, life without parole sentences are much different than any other sentence in the state of New Hampshire. As judges, you know that, and as practicing attorneys, you know that, because other individual crimes have determinate sentences. You get out after a period of time. You have relief, parole, 651-20 relief in Superior Court, motions to reduce. You have commissioners that can write letters and send you into the community with a bracelet on. That's not true. In life without parole sentences, in essence, they are civil death penalty sentences. They will kill you unless you have an avenue of relief.
Where is it set forth in the Constitution or in any statute the degree of process that your client's entitled to? There's nothing.
Well, I think there is. Actually, I think like in any procedure where you assume that any branch of government will exercise some process and some discretion, that minimal due process under Part 1, Article 15, or Part 1, Article 14 of our own Constitution, and I think guaranteed in this situation under Part 1, Article 18, that we would get some relief.
Well, isn't this analogous? We did not have to offer you oral argument here today. We decide 75% or 80% of the cases that come before this court on the papers, and those people get due process. And why wouldn't you be making the same argument if we hadn't had oral argument in this case? Well, they didn't read it. There was no due process.
Well, actually, Judge, not to be offensive, but if it was denied by you, then I would have extinguished every remedy in state court, and I would still have avenues sometimes to go further. I have no avenue here. This is a perfect example of a petition for writ of mandamus. There is no other remedy.
But we don't have to have a hearing on it.
I believe, though, in this particular case, when you're dealing with a constitutional guarantee in the state of New Hampshire, where the folks that put our Constitution together said that we are not going to exterminate our citizens. We're not going to have them languish in prisons to die without hope. That yes, there is a special duty. There's a special duty on the governor and council to guarantee that. They took an oath to guarantee that. And what you saw on March 23rd, 2022 was almost a whimsical brush Pamela Smart away. Let's go on to the next item.
Counselor Warmington said she'd read all the materials. Can we not rely on that?
Counselor Warmington said she read all the materials. She patted the lawyers on the head and didn't comment about one substantive thing in that pardon petition.
Why was she required to, Mr. Sisti?
Why was she required to?
Why was she required to comment at all?
If she doesn't want to do her job, she doesn't have to do her job. I'm just saying that we're asking you to order. Well, I have to say, if we're going to get into a web and a cycle, a tornado of politics,
I think we're in it.
Right. But we have to break the chain of politics. And the only way I can do that, and the only way Pam Smart can do that, is to come before a panel that isn't burdened with politics, that isn't chained down to what, you know, Counselor Stevens is talking about.
Well, wasn't it adequate that you submitted hundreds of pages of documents? The state submitted hundreds of pages of documents. Assuming those were read, if they were read, why doesn't that satisfy due process?
One, I don't assume it. Two, it was brushed aside so quickly. In fact, I say 2 minutes and 34 seconds. If you look at that transcript, that hearing was over with in 44 seconds.
What were you asking for, then? The right to subpoena them to find out how much deliberation took place?
No, I'm asking this court, I'm asking the only place I can go, the only place Pam can go, to say, just do your job.
And what does that mean? What are we going to say?
Meaningful, minimal due process hearing that we even get at the Department of Motor Vehicles.
So are you asking for the right to appear before the Executive Council and Governor and to make your argument before them? Or are you asking us to tell the Governor and Council, do it again because you didn't do it the right time the first time?
Both. I think what I'm asking is that there's no evidence on the record, their own record, that indicates they did the job. None. One. And two, when you do it the next time, will you do it so that there's some transparency, so that we don't have to have a question from you, Justice Donovan?
And if they do that, can you come back to us and ask us to overturn their decision?
You know, if they truly exercise discretion, and words have meanings, and discretion means that they're circumspect, that they exercise good judgment in the context of what they're supposed to decide, if they hit all of those, then I would be foreclosed. But there's no evidence that they hit all of those.
But they need not write a fulsome opinion. You're asking for a hearing.
I am.
You're asking for assurances that the materials were reviewed, but there's no requirement that I'm aware of that they articulate the reasons for their decision.
I am.
That they have to have an exchange.
I believe that they are governed by, of course, the Constitution and the statutes. And under RSA 4, sections 21 through 28, they have certain affirmative duties to their constituents.
Such as
to actually look at and advise the governor, not just to summarily dismiss petitions that come before them. I mean, what's going on here is that, you know, Councillor Stevens says, my constituents would be offended, basically, if I let Pam Smart go. Well, you know, Pam Smart would have been one of her constituents. She has a lot of constituents. Her constituents should have the right to know that they're taking their jobs seriously and that it's just not being brushed aside. And the record that we have is just devoid of any attention that they took to decide this thing with the facts and their duty as a background. It's not there.
You agree you have no evidence that they didn't spend hours poring over those materials.
I have no evidence they even looked at those materials. I have nothing. There's not one peel off that onion that indicates they took a serious look at this. And in fact, even the standard that Councillor Stevens states on the record is not the standard under State v. Farrell.
I don't understand how you can say it's not transparent. There was a public hearing. The governor was there. The executive councillors were there. They took up the petition and they ruled on it.
I don't know what record.
How much more transparent could it be if they're politically operating in bad faith or whatever? Isn't the remedy in the ballot box?
No, the remedy for Pam Smart's not the ballot box. The remedy for Pam Smart is in a properly operating executive council that is following what their duty is.
So you're saying they're not doing their job, but isn't that ultimately the decision of the voters? And
no.
Here, you can't point to anything to say, this is what they were supposed to do, this is what they were supposed to do, and they didn't do it.
Well, I think I can, actually, because I have referred to the statutes, and I'm looking at a transcript. That's a transcript. That's not transparency. It's almost a joke. If I sent this to you for your review so that you could come to a reasoned decision on a prior hearing, you wouldn't be able to do it. You'd say, I remand. We need more facts. We need to flesh this out. We don't need.
But that's if we're being asked to review the substance of the decision, and that's not what this is about. This is about process.
Right, but
or
the
a
substance,
claim that this was not adequate process.
But the substance of the process isn't supported by the transcript either, is what I'm saying. I'm not asking, and of course I'm not asking, for you folks to give me a decision on the merits. That would be foolish. That's not what you're here to do. The guarantee that I'm asking for is a guarantee that the executive council do their job, not that you do your job. I hope I never have to come back here with regard to this case. I hope we can get our remedy under Part 1, Article 14 in front of the proper body, and that's the governor and council.
Is there any limitation to the number of commutation petitions you can file?
There isn't, but if you look at this, she's already foreclosed when Councillor Stevens says, I'm absolutely convinced there's no evidence or argument that rises to the level of granting commutation requests for Pam Smart. And I just want to quote Associate General Attorney General Swelson said, Greg Smart's loss of life and the impact on his family and friends far outweigh whatever adversity the petitioner has faced in prison. We must never forget Greg. He would have been my constituent. He also stated, a commutation of Pamela Smart's sentence demeans the value of Greg Smart's life and diminishes the suffering of the entire Smart family. That's not the test.
That's this council and this governor. There will be another council and another governor at some point in time.
So how do we instruct them to do their job? They get to do Councillor Stevens, or do they get to get some guidance finally that when a petition comes to you, especially when it's a life without parole petition, you must take it seriously. You must let the public know that you actually considered it so that justices at the Supreme Court don't have to guess whether you reviewed one page or 1,000 pages of the petition.
Thank you, Mr.
Thank
Sissy.
You.
Your red light is on. You have reserved 2 minutes.
Thank you.
Ms. Lombardi.
Good morning. May it please the court, I'm Laura Lombardi representing the state. This court lacks jurisdiction to review the actions of governor and council in this case.
How can you say that? I mean, we're here talking about the actions. You're saying we don't have jurisdiction for you to stand here and argue?
Exactly.
Would you like to leave?
No, since you have accepted the case and I am here, but I am surprised that we are here and that the court accepted this case, because it is clear that there is no jurisdiction here. The state.
But haven't we said in a number of cases that there are still constitutional bounds to the prerogatives of the other branches? And for example, if the executive council had said, well, on a racial basis, we're not going to take this up, there would be a constitutional argument that would be properly before us. Isn't that right?
That is correct, if there were a constitutional argument. Here, we do not have a constitutional argument. The argument raised here has to do with the procedure that governor and council must follow when considering a clemency application.
Isn't due process a constitutional argument?
Due process is, but there is no due process here. There is no due process right to any particular process with regards to a clemency application. In Connecticut Board of Pardons versus Dumschat, the United States Supreme Court held that when a state constitution imposes no limits on the procedure to be followed by a governor in issuing clemency, or what evidence to be considered, or what criteria to apply, then an inmate has no protectable liberty interest in an application.
What's the date of that decision, out of curiosity?
It dates back to 1981.
That was then, and this is now.
That holding has not been changed since that time. The Woodard case raises the question whether there could possibly be a due process interest in a death row inmate, but that case is limited. It's a splinter decision, and it's also limited to the capital case. So in terms of someone who is in...
So life without parole is not an analog to a capital case?
No,
as counsel indicated?
No, it is not. And the argument about the petitioner's sentence being a sentence of extermination does not follow. That is relying on Part 1, Article 18 of the state constitution. And that article is relating to the legislature's power. It does not relate to the governor's clemency power. It relates to the legislature's power in affixing punishment for crimes. And it places limits on the legislature in how they establish penalties for a crime. It is not related at all to the governor's clemency powers.
So Mr. Sisti asks in his pleadings that we order the executive council to perform in good faith. Do you deny that they should perform their duties in good faith?
No, they should, and they did apply their duties in good faith. But this court lacks jurisdiction to order governor and council to act in good faith. This court's jurisdiction relates to constitutional issues. So, for example, Part 2, Article 15.
But let's go back to that. Jurisdiction, as you know better than anyone, is the power to say, the power to decide, as opposed to a justiciability issue, which is, I think, the real nub here. And who gets to decide what is justiciable and what isn't? And the answer to that is the courts. So it's not, to me, a jurisdictional issue at all.
Non-justiciability in political questions does relate back to jurisdiction. But you are correct that this court determines whether an issue is justiciable. And here, to do that, you would look at Part 2, Article 52, the clemency power. And that directly places the power in the hands of the governor. For instance, there are two limits in that article to the power. So one would be that the governor cannot pardon someone who's been impeached by the legislature. So if the governor were to attempt to pardon someone who's been impeached by the legislature, there would be a jurisdiction here in the court to challenge that decision, because the argument in that case would be that the governor has exceeded his constitutional authority under Part 2, Article 52. Here, there's no argument that the governor has exceeded his constitutional authority. The argument is an argument that governor and council acted in bad faith. But it is the exercise of discretion. This court recently, just last summer, in the Richards case, found that where the Constitution did not require the legislature to hold a hearing on a particular issue, that a claim that The Speaker of the House and the President of the Senate abused their discretion in deciding not to hold a hearing was non-justiciable in this
court. So in your view, if a governor and counsel pardoned somebody over the state's objection, you don't have a remedy. You can't come here and complain about it.
That is correct. And I think it's important to point out that this is not about justice. This is about mercy. So the petitioner received all the justice to which she was entitled through the criminal proceedings and any collateral proceedings through the judicial branch that she could have brought. And she has done that.
I think your opponent has conceded all of that. What's the point?
The point is he uses the phrase due process over and over. There is no due process at issue in this case. Pamela Smart has no protectable constitutional interest in receiving commutation of her sentence. This is a matter of mercy and grace held by the executive branch.
So could the governor and the executive council just refuse to even discuss or take up a petition for clemency?
The governor could choose not to put it on the agenda, correct. His power is with the advice of counsel. So if the governor were to review all the materials and determine that he would never grant a pardon or commutation in the case, he could choose not to put it on counsel's
agenda. So it never even, in your view, it never even had to be presented to the counselors?
Correct. And here it was presented to the counselors. It was placed on the agenda. And I'd like to point out, there's all this discussion about, well, only less than 3 minutes was given to the petitioner's issue. Well, if you look at the minutes from the council meeting, the second to the last page of the third appendix filed by the petitioner, the item immediately before the petitioner's was a petition by another inmate, Teresa Marie Pepin, for a pardon, seeking a pardon hearing from her charge of attempted murder. The council spent less than 1 minute on hers. There was absolutely...
Well, you mean comparative injustice is all right? I don't understand that.
No, it's showing that there was no abuse of discretion. There was no unusual treatment of the petitioner in this case. There was 127, I believe, items on the agenda. They received, as was pointed out earlier, the council members received significant volumes of information to review prior to the meeting. The governor put it on the agenda, and they voted the same way that they did for the individual who was on the agenda
directly
before.
Well, certainly if there's a constitutional right at issue, it shouldn't matter whether there's one issue on the agenda or 127 or 200, right?
If there was a constitutional issue at stake, and there was not. Again, this does not have to do with justice. This has to do with mercy. And the mercy that's held by the governor is strictly held by the judicial branch. It's essentially, the clemency power is essentially a check on both the legislative and the judicial branches of government. The legislature, under Article 5, has the power to define crimes and to fix the degree of punishment. The judiciary then has the power to adjudicate individual cases and to sentence individual defendants. The clemency power provides a check on these two branches of government by granting the governor the discretion to extend mercy and grace where appropriate.
That's a check after the fact. I don't really see
yes.
it as a check. It's an ameliorative mechanism by which a result that's deemed to be by someone with authority to be unjust can be rectified.
Correct. And doing that after the fact, after the judicial process has been completed, to then allow judicial review of the governor's exercise of that power would be inconsistent with our system of checks and balances. In this case, the governor did place the matter on the agenda. The council considered it. They voted to deny a hearing. They followed the same process that they typically would process. And the very argument that there was some abuse of discretion is not subject to judicial review under this court's case law relating to political questions.
Ms. Lombardi, if this matter was put on the agenda but no materials were circulated, that would be fine from your perspective? Constitutionally fine?
If the applicant did not file any material supporting their request.
No, well, the materials were filed, but they weren't given to the counselors.
Right. If that were the case, wouldn't there be a real issue, a due process issue?
I don't believe so. Again, I don't think due process would ever come into play. The only way due process would come into play is if, so some states have state constitutions that authorize the legislature to issue laws relating to the procedures that the governor and council might use. So if our constitution either allowed the legislature to do so, or if the constitution specifically provided a process, then there could possibly be a due process.
What is Ms. Smart's remedy? Assuming she didn't get a fair shake here, what's her remedy?
There is no remedy, because again, she doesn't have a right. She doesn't have a legal right to a hearing.
Well, she can file another commutation petition, can't she?
She can.
She can go to the legislature and ask the legislature to reconsider whether parole should be granted to people who've been sentenced to life.
There could be avenues through the political branches. And again, there was discussion about whether governor and council have to answer to their constituents, and they do. And it is through the political process that they would answer to their constituents, not through a judicial review of their actions. The United States Supreme Court in Cavazos versus Smith pointed out, with relating to clemency, that it is not for the judicial branch to determine the standards for the discretion. If the clemency power is exercised too generously or too stingy a way, that calls for political correctiveness, not judicial intervention.
If it were wholly arbitrary and based upon a prohibitive reason, such as racial bias?
That could potentially be justiciable. If there was, again, a constitutional claim, there is no requirement for governor and council to create rules or policies regarding the process. If the governor were to create rules or policies, that they would not be reviewable by the court. If the governor would, for instance,
within
create
a policy... Within the confines of the Constitution, which does set forth a basic process in Part 2, Article 52, correct? There must be... notice to state's counsel, prosecuting officer may be required to furnish a statement. So there is a basic outline of a process.
That is, you're citing to statutes. So those are requirements that the right. legislature has created. And they do not put any requirements on the governor or council. They put requirements on people who are applying. So that is permissible. It would not be permissible for the legislature to enact a law that would restrict the governor or direct the governor how to exercise his right. In similar fashion, this court, it would be a violation of separation of powers for this court to create standards of review. So for instance, the Farrow case that the petitioner relies on, you have to read that language in the context of the constitutional limitations on the on the judicial branch set forth in the Constitution. So this court could not, the language that the petitioner relies on does not create a standard for determining whether someone could be subject to clemency. So again, the petitioner here does not have any legal right to any further process, and this court lacks the authority to either review the council's decision to deny her a hearing or to order the governor to provide any further process. So if there are no further questions, I would ask that you dismiss the petition for lack of jurisdiction.
Thank you, Ms. Lombardi. Mr. Sisti?
Thank you, Your Honor. Just a couple of quick responses, and I'll sign off. But the Pepin case that preceded Smart's petition, Pepin's out. Pepin had other relief. Pepin had a determinate sentence. Pepin had parole. Pepin had 65120. Pepin had avenues other than the governor and council. So let's not even mix that up. And with regard to discretion, there was none exercised here. And there's no evidence of it. What's really going on here is that the state is advocating a long, painful extermination of a New Hampshire citizen when our own Constitution says you can't do it. And then they're saying, not only can we authorize that, but you have no place to go for relief. Now, isn't that an interesting thing to announce to the state of New Hampshire, to the folks here, that you have no relief, you can go nowhere, you're condemned. Enter here. ye have no hope. A life without parole sentence should, with that sentence, hitch on to something, and it should be hope. Because if you don't give hope to people inside, you're going to see that it will be problematic. Hope drives people. And what I think I'm really asking this body to do, really asking you to do, is to announce to the governor and council that they should, in the spirit of Part 1, Article 18, take care of the citizens of this state, give them hope. Even those that committed the worst crimes in the world should have hope. Not 44 seconds of taking a vote and denying it, and not the hatred that one counselor can give to an individual that's incarcerated. And as we sit here today, other people have had hope. I can name four of them, all co-defendants in this case, that were released in 2005 and 2018, and I assure you, they're watching this proceeding now in the comfort of their own home. So there is hope and there's success. And I'm asking that you give Pam Smart that little inkling, that little crack in the door where she can have hope. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Sisti. Case submitted.
Submitted.
Court will take a brief recess.
Go ahead.